interesting, some of these difficult pieces that he has, but you will find it very amusing and exciting as well. So we welcome you, and I'd like to bring out now Walter Thomas Patterson.
There we go.
Perfect. All right. Well, thank you everyone for coming out, and I am so excited to share my music with you. I have some exciting pieces chosen, and just so you know, the program has changed a little bit. So the second half on your on the programs, the ones that are printed, I'll be playing the Schubert first on the first half. So, and then everything else will come on the second half. So, I'm especially excited for the Schubert because it's a piece that I've been working on for a long time. It's actually four movements, but I'm gonna be playing three of the movements. The fourth movement is quite long, and I think for the purposes of this concert, it would make it a very, very long first half. So I'm gonna be starting off with the first movement of the sonata, and I think it's important to know that Schubert wrote this sonata a few months before he died. So he's writing knowing that he's terminally ill, and I think he writes in a very mournful and very somber tone. And I think really what I listen for in this movement is how he creates these long melodic lines that seem to be interminable. And it's interesting because when this piece was initially published, a lot of people were like, it's just so long, it's so, it goes on for too long. But I think when you take time to really immerse yourself within the melodic lines and within the texture, it becomes very moving and very powerful. So here's the first movement of Schubert's B flat major sonata.
Thank you.
So that was the first movement of Schubert's B flat major sonata. And now I'll play the second movement, which in a sonata form, it is traditionally a slow movement. So this, and this movement definitely reflects that. So it's marked andante sostenuto, which is a little bit faster actually than you know, like a lento, you know, really slow. But it really, Schubert spends a lot of time really developing the melodic line that you hear at the beginning. So listen for the ways that it comes back throughout the movement, the opening line. And this movement, similar to the first movement, is very very melancholic and very reflective. So here is the second movement of Schubert's B flat major sonata.
Thank you.
So that was the second movement of Schubert's B-flat major sonata. And now to finish out the first half, I'll be playing the third movement. Now, this movement is quite the departure from the past two movements. And it is written Allegro vivace con delicatezza. So it's very lively, and he kind of awakens from a slumber, it seems, in this movement. And here is the third movement of Schubert's B-flat major sonata.
Thank you.
So we'll just take a few moments, and then Walter will be back for his next pieces that he's going to do. And I hope you've enjoyed that. I know piano player myself, but nothing like that. So parishioners don't expect that from me. Okay, Walter's ready to perform his next piece. And like I said, Walter is new to the Sacred Heart Concert Series, and I've had the privilege to work with him over the past several weeks, and I've had the privilege to get to know him, and just a great person that he is. And I know his parents are watching this evening through live stream, and I assure you he's in good hands, and it's an honor to actually play with him, and it's an honor to have meet him, and he's just a great kid. So, ladies and gentlemen, I welcome back to you, Walter.
So for the second half of the concert, we move from the early 1800s to the early 1900s, and I'm going to be starting off with three preludes by Claude Debussy, and you'll see they're all titled. They all have very specific titles, and they all are supposed to represent. Debussy would travel around Europe and would see all these different. He would go to all these different sites, and he would see all these. He would, you know, take note of what he was seeing, and then he would write about them, or he would, you know, he would write them down and put them into music. So the first prelude is entitled "Les Collines d'Anacapri," and that is based on the hills of Anacapri, which are these very beautiful, these very beautiful vistas and hills in Europe. And then the second prelude is entitled. La Cathédrale Engloutie. Now this is a little bit more more fantastic prelude, and it actually translates into the sunken cathedral. So this the prelude is kind of based on this myth, and Debussy is trying to in the prelude he's trying to evoke the image and the vision of this cathedral rising out of the sea. So it's a very, very mysterious. And then the final prelude is titled Minstrels, and it's based on these traveling groups of performers that would come around and go to different cities and kind of perform, and it's very kind of, very lighthearted, and just learning the piece, I laughed at a few moments because of just how of the kinds of different markings he puts in the music, like mocking and like a drum and like, and it's like a juggler. So it's very, he's very, he really wants to make the listener and the player think about what it would be like to be in his time. So without further ado, here are the three Debussy preludes.
Thank you.
next piece brings me to the Spanish composer, Enrique Granados, and I'll be playing his piece entitled La Maja y el Ruiseñor, which translates to The Maiden and Nightingale. Now, this piece is part of a larger suite he wrote for piano, and this is a fourth piece, and the suite that this piece is a part of really represents some of the height of Granados' composing. So you really see, in this piece, you see a lot of influences from composers like Chopin, like Bach, and it's really this rich, embellished tone that really I haven't found in a lot of other composers. So, and one thing that I really have what I love about this, one of the things that I most love is how his voicing is so rich. So you'll hear voices and then a treble and the bass clef, and he finds his way of weaving these melodies throughout these different lines, and it makes for a really interesting piece to learn and also to play, because I do my best to really try to portray that. One other thing you should also be aware of is in the final page of the piece, you will hear what sounds like, now I don't know how good it is, but it's supposed to be this bird that's flying away. So if you can tell where the bird comes in, I'll be impressed, because I can tell Granados was really trying. He really wants the audience to think, okay, this is this nightingale, right? So here is La Maja y el Ruiseñor.
Thank you.
final piece I'll play tonight, I think only needs two things for you to know. The first is that jeu d'eau translates into water sports in French, and that Ravel wrote this when he was